Once again, we welcome you to the study circle meeting. Today we have with us senior counsel Sri Om Prakash, and he requests no introduction. I leave the floor to him. Welcome, sir.
Today we will have a small thought on a topic called fraudulent transactions. Taken it only in one of the facets of this fraudulent transaction, I am just trying to put across to you my thoughts on this topic in the context of how a fraudulent transaction has been dealt with under the Transfer of Property Act, and thereafter how it has traveled till date up to the latest Insolvency and Bankruptcy Code. And even in this journey, I am not going to travel anywhere outside. I will only focus on what a fraudulent transaction means in terms of Section 53 of the Transfer of Property Act. And that will be in a context that if there is a transaction which seeks to defeat the rights of a creditor, it is seen as a fraudulent transaction. So therefore, from there we will travel to the Companies Act provisions as to how the fraudulent transaction has been dealt with under the Companies Act 1956. Then we will look at what Companies Act 2013 provided in respect of fraudulent transactions, and thereafter the Insolvency and Bankruptcy Code. So this is going to be the thought process as far as today's session is concerned, the travel which we will make from Transfer of Property Act to the Insolvency and Bankruptcy Code. The moment we hear about fraudulent transactions, so many things would come to our mind. We look into a context that when we say about fraudulent transaction, transactions which create certain rights on properties by fraudulent means, transactions where properties are dealt with by persons by fraudulent acts, say cases of impersonation, say cases where without any property a transaction being dealt. So these are all so many things which normally you come across in criminal proceedings. You find criminal prosecutions launched against persons under Section 420 and so many other provisions. This is what which comes to us, come to our mind when we speak about fraudulent transactions. You are all very well aware how fraud is defined, what fraud means. In simple terms, if I have to say, under the provisions of Indian Penal Code, the term fraudulent is explained in Section 25 of the Code. According to Section 25 of IPC, when a thing is done by a person with an intention to defraud the other, he is said to have done that thing fraudulently. So therefore, if a person is sought to be deceived or a person is sought to be defrauded, and if there is an intention to defraud, that is the fraudulent transaction. There are so much of jurisprudence on what fraud means, what is the prosecution for fraud, so much other things. I will only take one judgment for a small explanation. This is a case reported in AR 1963, SC 1572. Titled Dr. Vimala versus Delhi Administration. In this case, the Supreme Court set down the context in which a fraud has to be investigated or prosecuted. It ultimately pointed out that there should be an intention of deceit. Unless in a transaction, if there is no deceit, it is not a fraudulent transaction. Then it went on to say that this transaction or this act should result in an injury to a person who is the deceived person. So injury doesn't only mean economic loss, it includes deprivation of property or money and includes harm caused to any persons in body, mind, reputation, so on so. So therefore, two things which the Supreme Court identified is that there should be deceit and there should be an injury to the person who is deceived. So effectively, a fraudulent transfer signifies a transfer that takes place in order to deceive or defraud another. Now, this is an interesting case, Dr. Vimala versus Delhi Administration, where a person takes an insurance policy in the name of her daughter. Facts are revealed that the daughter is a minor person, but she suppresses that. She takes a policy as if she is a major. She subscribes to it in the name of her daughter, and subsequently, when a claim is lodged, she also receives the money in the name of the daughter. All things done and said. Now, subsequently, it comes to notice that this lady had done this entire act when the actual daughter was only a minor. Now, the court below, the up to high court, everyone had held that it was a fraudulent transaction. But interestingly, Supreme Court reversed the entire scenario, and Supreme Court found that the insurance policy which was taken was for a person. There is no dispute. And Supreme Court ultimately said, in terms of that policy, whatever money has to be received has been received. There is no dispute. And Supreme Court says that the person who is said, whose name is said to have been, is namely the daughter, she has not made any complaint or she has not been suffered any injury. So in all this context, I'm only simplifying the facts just to not waste time much on it. On those contexts, Supreme Court set out the definition of this fraud in these two simple terms as deceit and an injury caused to the person who is deceived. So this is how, this is a small background as regarding fraud. Now with this, let us get to the topic of the day. We are only looking at what is a fraudulent transaction or transfer or preference. Though we have given the topic as fraudulent transaction, within it encompasses the fraudulent transfers, the fraudulent preferences, because these are the different terminologies used in the other enactments. Now for this fraudulent transfer, let us see section 53 of Transfer of Property Act. Now I will just read section 53 of Transfer of Property Act, then let us get into it. Now 53 of Transfer of Property Act says, every transfer of immovable property made with intent to defeat or delay the creditors of the transferor shall be voidable at the option of any creditor so defeated or delayed. Nothing in this subsection shall impair the rights of a transferee in good faith and for consideration. Nothing in this subsection shall affect any law for the time being in force relating to insolvency. A suit instituted by a creditor, which term include a decree holder, whether he has or has not applied for execution of his decree, to avoid a transfer on the ground that it has been made with intent to defeat or delay the creditors of the transferor, shall be instituted on behalf of or for the benefit of all the creditors. Every transfer of immovable property made without consideration with intent to defraud a subsequent transferee shall be voidable at the option of subsequent transferee. For the purposes of this subsection, no transfer made without consideration shall be deemed to have been made with intent to defraud by reason only that a subsequent transfer for consideration was made. So from what the definition we saw as to the fraudulent transaction, we are now bringing it to a narrow area as far as TP Act is concerned. So Transfer of Property Act recognizes a fraudulent transfer as a transfer which has been done with an intention to defeat the rights of creditors. So as early as an 1882, you can find that the creditor has been placed at a higher pedestal. So creditor was paramount when there were transactions relating to properties. Now ultimately, from what I have read in section 53, what you can find is subsection 1 says there shall be a transferor, there shall be a transfer of a property. The person is called a transferor. And it shall be of an immovable property. And such transfer is with an intention to defeat or delay his creditors. And then it says, if all these parameters are satisfied, the transfer is voidable at the option of the creditor, defeated or delayed. Now, is there any protection which is given in respect of transactions which are falling within section 53? If you see that, it says any action which is taken in good faith, any transfer in good faith and for valid consideration, you have an exception. A transfer can be challenged on the ground that it affects 53, but still if you are able to establish that this transfer was for a valid consideration and it was in a good faith, then still you can bring that transfer outside the purview of 53. Now what 53.2 says, it again says if a transfer by a person of an immovable property is done without consideration. And that is also to be treated as a transfer done with an intention to defraud the subsequent transferee. Such transfer is again voidable. So you have enough of case laws or enough of factual situations which you would have seen. Suppose a person incurs huge debts. Suddenly he makes a transfer in favor of one of his family members of a valuable property to keep that property away from the hands of the creditor. Then you would have seen so many cases where, in spite of so many debts, one creditor would have been preferred and one property would have been transferred. Or a creditor would have stepped in and said, I will take a transfer of this property in set off of the dues payable by you. So these are all the transactions. And likewise, there are many instances, because one of the oldest enactment from 1882, if you take, you have a lot of jurisprudence. I am not traveling much on that. I can only point out to you one or two crucial aspects is that, though the provision says voidable, you have judgments on the point saying that if a creditor who goes to the court and takes a decree and becomes a decree holder, and in the process of execution, if he seeks to attach a property, which later comes to his knowledge that there was a transfer effected, he need not file a suit and seek for setting aside of the transfer. The Supreme Court has said in judgment that a creditor, while in execution, can avoid this transfer and establish before the court that it is to be treated as a property of the judgment debtor and can be subjected to the execution proceedings and proceeded with. So this is one area. Then you will also have case laws which shows that it is not necessary that the intention to defeat a creditor should be for the entire creditors. Even if one creditor is sought to be avoided by a transfer, that also qualifies to be a fraudulent transaction or a fraudulent transfer under Section 53. So the ingredients you have seen, what makes out for this transfer to be treated as fraudulent, and what are all the protections which the section is also given. So in that context, as I said, enough jurisprudence devolves on that, and you have a lot of case laws arising out of it. I just leave it to the members' interest to get into all those things and try to find out. I have pointed out this for the purpose that from one of the earliest enactment, you have a specific area dealing with fraudulent transactions. Now with this, let us travel to, I will also try to point out one or two things as far as this is concerned. As I said, the phrase creditors doesn't mean that the intention should be to defeat or delay all the creditors. If the intention is to defeat even one creditor, it still qualifies. Then cases where property is being transferred to the family members, and case where even a person, a lady who has a claim by way of a maintenance to be recovered from the husband, was treated to be a creditor, and any transfer made by him was also being subject matter of avoidance under Section 53. So these are all small instances which I'm pointing out. And in the earliest jurisprudence, you would find that most of these cases under Section 53 were dealt by filing a suit. In fact, the earlier requirement was that you need to file a suit to declare the sale as null and void or to make out a case for avoidance of the transfer, because the provision ultimately says it is voidable. So therefore, once it comes to the issue of filing a suit, as you know, in a general civil courts, in terms of the civil procedure code, there is so much of action which the plaintiff has to make in terms of pleadings, in terms of documents. Then there would be a heavy burden of proof which is also lying on him. Likewise, if you are able to show that there is an indebtedness for a person, there are huge number of creditors who have to recover the amounts from the particular person, and still whatever property he had, he has dealt with it. The burden may shift to the person to show that the transaction was a bona fide transaction or a transaction taken in good faith and for a valuable consideration. So it will have a shifting of the burden of proof from the initial stage, which is with the creditors, and then which is shifting to the debtor. So this is on the transfer, fraudulent transfer under the Transfer of Property Act. Now from here, let us move to the provisions under the Companies Act. As you are aware, the Companies Act 1956 provided for various modes in which a company can be administered. It cast upon various obligations on the persons, namely the directors of the company or the persons involved in the day-to-day affairs of the company. All those things are there. Now, in cases of, again, let us go back to the relationship of a creditor and debtor. Now, in case of a company being a debtor, as you are aware that the Companies Act 1956 provided for winding up of the company on the grounds of inability to pay the debt. So this was one ground in which a person, a creditor, can approach the company court and seek for winding up of the company. Now, if a winding up happens, what happens to the assets, or what happens, or in what manner the assets of the companies are dealt with? And is there any scope on this aspect of fraudulent transaction or fraudulent preferences within that? So this is the next area of which we are trying to look into. So therefore, under the Companies Act, invariably post winding up proceedings, once the company is vested with the liquidator, the transactions are put to test. There are two important provisions which are of much use. One is Section 536 of the old Act. I am speaking about Companies Act 1956, where any transaction can be validated only by an order of the court. So therefore, any transaction after the filing of the company petition and before which an order of winding up is made, because there is a time period. I initiate a company petition, the winding up order may come after 2 years. But in the meanwhile, if the company had dealt with the property, there is a requirement of validating such transaction, which was dealt with Section 536 by approaching the company court. Then there was one more aspect of the directors being accountable to the various acts. The liquidator was required to look into the affairs of the company. In the process of winding up, once the winding up is ordered, in fact, the first requirement in terms of Companies Act as well as the company court rules is that the directors of the company were supposed to file a document called Statement of Affairs. They were supposed to disclose to the liquidator that this is the assets available, this is the liabilities to the company, and these had been all the transactions which the company had gone through over a period of time. Now, the liquidator will analyze the statement of affairs, will analyze the books of accounts, and will first, at the first instance, take charge of all the assets which are available. Now, post that, the liquidator was also required to look into why there had been instances of this default or a debt which the company is not able to service. Now, in that context, one important application which the liquidator will bring before the court is that application for misfeasance and malfeasance against the directors. So there the liquidator will point out that certain transactions which the directors dealt, which the company has undertaken, or certain transactions which qualified to be a fraudulent transaction will be tested. Now, in that context, if the liquidator finds that there have been certain acts of the directors or certain transactions which the company had undertaken ultimately is to defeat the rights of the creditors, or ultimately resulted in a situation where the company has been put to loss, or that the situation of insolvency was only because of those conducts. Take the example, suppose if a company had a valuable property or a division of a manufacturing unit, the directors for some reason choose to transfer that unit to some other person. Now, these transactions will be put to test, and that test and the process in which the directors would be made accountable is what we call as a misfeasance and malfeasance application. Though the object of this provision and the context in which it is set down is very laudable, if you go and see the jurisprudence, these applications have seldom given any big result. There have been very many, the success ratio of these applications of trying to bring back the assets of the company to the liquidation estate or the estate which is vesting with the official liquidator is very, very less. It is hardly about 5 to 10%. But the object behind this is that to test all these transactions. So that is where these transactions were seen, whether it was any consequences of wrongful or fraudulent acts. So the misfeasance applications which is being brought against the directors were in a context to to test whether the transactions were wrongful or fraudulent. One of the earliest cases which you can see is a case reported in 1973, 1 SEC 602, in the title of Official Liquidator versus Supreme Bank. I will just read one paragraph of it. It goes on to say that the director cannot shut his eyes to what must be obvious to everyone who examines the affairs of the company, even superficially. If he does so, he could be held liable for dereliction of duties undertaken by him and compelled to make good the losses incurred by the company due to his neglect, even if he is not shown guilty of participating in the commission of fraud. It is enough if his negligence is of such a character as to enable frauds to be committed and losses thereby incurred by the company. So this was the touchstone. From the fraudulent transaction, now you look at a conduct of a director who has a fiduciary capacity in a company, who has got an obligation to perform in the company. If such conduct, even in the eyes of a superficial examination, if it comes that he could not have done it, then the court says he has to make good the losses. He is said to have undertaken a fraudulent transaction. And though he may not be guilty in participation, is what ultimately this court said. So similarly, in the case of Official Liquidator versus Ram Swarup, reported in AR 1997, Allahabad 72, the court held that charges of misfeasance and fraudulent trading were made out against the party under Section 542 of Companies Act. The court held that the directors occupied a fiduciary position and proceedings under Section 542 can be of civil nature and hence they are liable to compensate the company. So you would find that the Companies Act brought in a situation where the assets of the company has to be protected, where if it is found that there are certain fraudulent transactions, fraudulent trading and fraudulent preferences which had happened, proceedings have to be initiated to bring back those assets to the company. This is otherwise called as disgorgement. You have to bring back all the assets. Now in this context, the Supreme Court had many cases where they went on to explain what can be the steps. The court held in one of the cases that a mere failure to initiate legal steps against the debtors of the company would not make the directors liable in the recovery of amounts unless it was proved that they had a fraudulent intention. So again, as in the case of Transfer of Property Act, you have a lot of jurisprudence evolving in cases under the provisions of Companies Act, where these fraudulent transactions. Now we have traveled from Transfer of Property to Companies Act, you would have seen the shift. It is not only related to immovable property, it also relates to movables, it also relates to carrying out business, which effectively means trading activities or manufacturing activities, whatever it is. So all these things were also brought within the purview of a fraudulent transaction and therefore were subject matter of various litigations. And ultimately, court laid down the path as to how this has to be identified, how it has to be brought forth. Then in one of the cases, the court said the liability under the provisions of Section 543 is in the nature of tortious liability and quasi-criminal as well. And therefore, the recovery can be directed to be made from the director who is held liable for causing loss to the company by his act and omissions, which tantamount to misappropriation, breach of trust, misapplication, and retention of monies and properties of the company. So therefore, while a director is carrying on this activity as a director of the company, he has lot of onerous responsibilities which he has to carry through himself. And in the process, he has to protect the assets of the company. So this is under the Companies Act 1956. Then, as I said, the travel from Transfer of Property Act to this provisions. And this again takes us to the Companies Act 2013. Now let us see two or three sections of Companies Act 2013. Section 239. I will just take you to these sections. Three sections would be of important. I don't know whether Shivashanmugam has and he goes for a screen share. In any case, I will just point out, first let us see 328 of Companies Act 2013. it speaks about fraudulent preference, where a company has given preference to a person who is one of the creditors of the company or a surety or guarantor for any of the debts or other liabilities of the company, and the company does anything or suffers anything done which has the effect of putting that person into a position which, in the event of company going into liquidation, will be better than the position he would have had, he would have been if in that thing had not been done prior to 6 months of making winding up application. The tribunal, if satisfied that such transaction is a fraudulent preference, may order as it may think fit for restoring the position to what it would have been if the company had not given that preference. If the tribunal is satisfied that there is a preference transfer of property, movable or immovable, or any delivery of goods, payment, execution made, taken or done by or against a company within 6 months before making up or winding up application, the tribunal may order as it may think fit and may declare such transaction invalid and restore the position. So 328 speaks about lot of fraudulent preferences involving immovables, movables, part of the business activity, trading, as I said, delivery of goods, payment of monies, all those things. And the time period which they have fixed is 6 months prior to the filing of application. So post filing of application, then orders, everything is there. So all these transactions can be put to test. Now then 329 provided a protection as in the case of earlier, which said any transfer of property, movable or immovable, or any delivery of goods made by a company, not being a transfer or delivery made in the ordinary course of its business, or in favor of a purchaser or encumbrancer in good faith and for valuable consideration, if made within a period of 1 year before the presentation of petition under this act, shall be void against the company liquidator. So this is in furtherance to 328, 329, they have also said certain things to be void, and they have also given a protection as far as good faith and valuable consideration. Then it also speaks about certain transfers to be void. Let us not be concerned about it. Now with this, what is that the Companies Act 2013 provides is that 339, liability for fraudulent conduct of business. If in the course of winding up of a company, it appears that any business of a company has been carried on with intent to defraud creditors of a company or any other person or for any fraudulent purpose, the tribunal, on the application of the liquidator or the company liquidator or any creditor or contributory of the company, may, if it thinks proper to do so, declare that any person who is or has been a director, manager or officer of the company, or any person who were knowingly parties to carrying on the off of the business in the manner aforesaid, shall be personally responsible without any limitation of liability for any or any of the debts or other liabilities of the company as the tribunal may direct. Then it goes on to say, provided that on the hearing of an application under the subsection, the official liquidator or the company liquidator, as the case may be, may himself give evidence or call witnesses. Where the tribunal makes any such declaration, it may give such further directions as it thinks proper for the purpose of giving effect to that declaration. And in particular, so it goes on to explain various things. Then 340 speaks about power of tribunal to assess damage against delinquent directors. Then 341 speaks about liability under section 339 and 340 to extend to partners and directors in firms of companies. So in as far as Companies Act 2013, as I pointed out to you, specific provision which speaks about the fraudulent preferences or fraudulent transactions. In addition to that, it speaks about the liability being fixed on the directors, and it has gone to the extent of further expanding the provisions from the earlier enactment to fixing of liability. It also goes to the extent of saying that they will be liable to the extent of where the debts have to be paid by the company. So you please see how the expansion has happened now. It is not only the question of the fraudulent transfer or the property which was lost, which had to be brought back to the company. Then the question of directors being personally liable for that. And from there, now it proceeds to saying that if this fraudulent preference or fraudulent transaction is identified during the winding up proceedings, to the extent of the debts which the company is liable, the directors will be made liable. So this is what 2013 Act has further expanded. And the provisions also make it clear, all this can be tested before tribunal in terms of section 339, 340 and 341. So this is the next area of fraudulent preferences which has taken shape. Now the common underlying factor as far as all these things, you can think about or you can even question me saying that, how is that the provision of a TP Act under section 53 is you are equating to the provisions under the Companies Act? The answer is, the common thread which runs through is that ultimately it is in the context of the creditors. If the creditors or rights are sought to be defeated, that is where I said these tests and the Companies Act comes in the cases of winding up proceedings. So therefore, if a winding up happens and if it is in the hands of the liquidator, so these tests are put in. So as a lawyers, what is our concern? As far as 2013 Act is concerned, you can look at fraudulent transactions happening. So therefore, even a transfer of an immovable property can be a subject matter of challenge or test or question in a subsequent proceedings when a winding up of the company happens. And as I said, the time limit is there. Then you can look at the liability which is being fastened on the directors and how the liquidator has powers to proceed against them. So this is on the second limb as regarding the topic of the day. Now with this, let us look into the other aspect of it, which is the latest enactment, namely Insolvency and Bankruptcy Code. Now let us see what the Insolvency and Bankruptcy Code speaks about it. Now, interestingly, the winding up provisions which are there in Companies Act 2013 is also now merged with Insolvency Code. In fact, an amendment has been brought and said that wherever winding up it was spoken to in the Companies Act 2013, now it is only nothing but an initiation of the proceedings for corporate insolvency resolution before the NCLT under the IBC. So therefore, this IBC also takes a important preference. Now let us see a few provisions. At the first instance, please see section. These sections are dealt with from section 43 onwards, which is preferential transactions. I will not touch upon much on that. This is a separate area which comes into. 45 speaks about avoidance and undervalued transaction. 45 of Insolvency and Bankruptcy speaks about avoidance and undervalued transactions. Now, if the liquidator or the resolution professional, as the case may be, on an examination of the transaction of the corporate debtor referred to in subsection 2, determines that certain transactions were made during the relevant period under section 46, which were undervalued, he shall make an application to the adjudicating authority to declare such transaction as void and reverse the effect of such transaction in accordance with this chapter. Now, subsection 2 says, a transaction shall be considered undervalued where the corporate debtor makes a gift to a person or enters into a transaction with a person which involves the transfer of one or more assets by the corporate debtor for a consideration the value of which is significantly less than the value of consideration provided by the corporate debtor, and such transaction has not taken place in the ordinary course of business of the corporate debtor. So all these transactions are sought to be classified or brought within the ambit of avoidance of undervalued transaction. As the section speaks, there is a time period which is called a twilight period. Now section 46 says relevant period for avoidable transactions. In an application for avoiding a transaction at undervalue, the liquidator or the resolution professional, as the case may, shall demonstrate that such transaction was made with a person within a period of 1 year preceding the insolvency commencement date. So transaction which can be put to test of avoidance or undervalued transactions should have happened within 1 year. This is subsection 1.1. Now subsection 1.2 says such transaction was made with a related party within a period of 2 years preceding. So therefore, if this transaction had been with a related party, it is 2 years period. Now, interestingly, this related party has got a wide definition under the Insolvency Bankruptcy Code. You can bring in every other person. If there is a director, shareholder, relative of him, his wife's relatives. So that is again one subject of discussion which can go on for a very long time. But take note of this term, related party. This is specifically defined. It was also amended at one point of time. So if it is a transaction with a related party, 2 years it can be tested. Now the adjudicating authority may require an independent expert to assess evidence relating to the value of transactions mentioned in this section. Now this is where a lot of materials which come before the NCLT is in the nature of transaction audit, forensic audit, valuation audit. So code gives room for all these things. It simply says an independent expert. So in a process of CIRP, the resolution professional will only ask for a transaction audit or a forensic audit from a person who can certify that these transactions were all undervalued or avoidable transactions. The moment it is so quoted, the RP gets a right to move the NCLT and say that these transactions has to be avoided. Now then section 47 speaks about application by creditor in cases of undervalued transaction. Now please see the thread which is underlying, which I kept on saying. Now, where an undervalued transaction has taken place and the liquidator or the resolution professional as the case has not reported it to the adjudicating authority. So in the earlier section, it is the liquidator or RP, resolution professional, he has to take the proceedings. Now next section says, suppose if he has not taken, a creditor, member or a partner of the corporate debtor, as the case may make an application to the adjudicating authority to declare such transactions void and reverse their effect in accordance with this chapter. So this is on 45, 46, 47. You have seen undervalued and avoidance transaction. Then we have seen what is the relevant period, then who can take. Now what is the relevancy for this to the fraudulent transaction is section 49. Section 49 says, transactions defrauding creditors. Now in this, where the corporate debtor has entered into an undervalued transaction as referred to in subsection 2 of section 45, and the adjudicating authority is satisfied that such transaction was deliberately entered into by such corporate debtor for keeping assets of the corporate debtor beyond the reach of any person who is entitled to make a claim against the corporate debtor, or in order to adversely affect the interest of such persons in relation to the claim, the adjudicating authority shall make an order restoring so and so. So what was an undervalued transaction and an avoidable transaction at the first instance, where the liquidator or the creditor all had a right? If it is found that such transaction was to defeat the rights of the creditor, this is the next limb. The moment it falls within the category of defeating the rights of the creditor, that becomes a fraudulent transaction under the IBC. Now, interestingly, under section 49, it doesn't specify a time limit. So therefore, if it is a simplister of avoidance and undervalued, time limit of 1 year, 2 years comes into play. Suppose if it partakes a character of a fraudulent transaction because it also defeats the rights of creditor, then probably the code means that there is no requirement of this period. So if undervalued transaction which defeats the rights of the creditor can be brought about, then you don't have a concern about this period of transaction. Now what it ultimately results is that the relief is the same. Transaction can be set aside, property can be restored, and whoever is involved, whoever was party to such transaction, you can get an order of disgorgement of that person to make good the loss which the company has suffered. So this is, now apart from this, section 66 also provides a kind of mechanism. Section 66 speaks about fraudulent trading or wrongful trading. If during the corporate insolvency resolution process or liquidation process, it is found that any business of the corporate debtor has been carried on with intent to defeat creditors or the corporate debtor, or for any fraudulent purpose, the adjudicating authority may, on an application of the resolution professional, pass an order that any persons who are knowingly parties to carrying on the business in such manner shall be liable to make such contributions to the assets of the corporate debtor as it may deem fit. On an application made by the resolution professional during the corporate insolvency, the adjudicating authority may, by an order, direct that a director or a partner of the corporate debtor, as the case may be, shall be liable to make such contribution to the assets of the corporate debtor as it may deem fit, if before the insolvency commencement date, such director or partner knew or ought to have known that there were no reasonable prospect of avoiding the commencement of corporate insolvency in respect of such corporate debtor, and such director or partner did not exercise due diligence in minimizing the potential loss to the creditors of the corporate debtor. Now, please see the ambit to which it goes. 66 starts with fraudulent trading, wrongful trading. Then it goes on to say, any action which is taken with an intent to defraud the creditors. Then it interestingly says, or for any fraudulent purpose. So this will take care of everything which you can bring. So it is need not necessary that this transaction was only to defeat the creditors. See, if the transaction had been for some other fraudulent purpose also, then there can be an application under 66. Now, if there is an application under 66, what is the consequences? Tribunal can restore back, bring back property. It can make the directors, partners liable to make such contribution to the assets. It does not even say value of what was lost or anything. You can ultimately assess whatever it is and bring back. Now, while assessing this again, the provision further says that if the director knew or ought to have known, this is a very, very subjective term. So you can always argue that he may not know, but he should have known that. What is that he should have known is that if a reasonable prospect of avoiding the commercial insolvency. So in all insolvencies, as far as CIRP proceedings are concerned and the IBC, my view is that this gives a lot of scope for forensic audit to be done, transaction audit to be done, and even an examination whether this could have been avoided. The CIRP being initiated itself could have been avoided. Now, it doesn't rest with saying that whether it could have been avoided. It goes on to say, if you are able to establish that on an examination during the CIRP process, the persons can be made accountable. So therefore, now, please see from then, this is one thing then you have, if you let go into small jurisprudence on how this devolved, if you look at it, this IBC provisions as to these fraudulent were all actually a borrowed concepts of United Kingdom's laws. The concept of fraudulent trading and wrongful trading was derived from the provisions of UK Insolvency Act 1986. And UK Insolvency Act brought in a committee to examine all these things, which is called the Cork Committee, and a huge report is there. Likewise, as far as Indian Insolvency Code is also concerned, you had a committee examining. In terms of the bankruptcy committee, the act came into place. So the act provided for all those things. So today's topic is concerned, the points which I wanted to derive for the members is that there is one area of this fraudulent transaction which touches upon the rights of creditors. And this area had been there throughout from the earliest enactment of Transfer of Property Act, which traveled to the Companies Act 1956 and Companies Act 2013 and Insolvency and Bankruptcy Code. So I only tried to give a small insight on this so that we will be enlightened on the point. And in fact, it gives you a lot of thought process to go into, be it the case of due diligence which we carry, be it the case of property purchases which we look, be it the case of title examinations which we see, and be it the case of acting on behalf of creditors before the tribunals in CIRP process. And if you have to protect the interest of the directors in a company which is under CIRP process. Now, all those things it requires that you have some kind of insight on these provisions. So this is my thought on the topic for the day. With this, I conclude and I will be happy to take any questions. And I would like, in fact, to have a more of an interactive on these aspects. Thank you very much.
See, what is the difference between the fraudulent and arising out of contracts and the Transfer of Property Act? What is the common line or common thread running between these acts?
Well, there is not in the context of today's topic, you may not find a common thread running there. Fraudulent under the context of Contracts Act, the fraudulent contracts are entirely different. Right? You have a specific definitions. You have contracts which are voidable, contracts which are void ab initio. So it falls under a different category. See, that is why I started off with my topic at the first instance, saying that common parlance of a fraudulent transaction is that it can be even a case where a person is defrauded in respect of a identity of property, a person is defrauded in respect of a executant of a contract, or a person is defrauded in respect of a representation in respect of the subject matter of contract. So these are all the things which fall under the fraudulent category under the Contracts Act. But what I tried to put across today is that under the same caption of fraudulent transactions, you have enactments which dealt with this fraudulent transaction as transactions which defeat the rights of the creditor. So one underlying thread is that if you are able to establish that the transaction was to defeat the right of the creditor, it is being termed as fraudulent. So therefore, that is the context under TP Act. So Transfer of Property Act was very, very specific to the point that if there is a fraudulent, if there is a transfer of property which ultimately defeats the right of creditor, it is a fraudulent transaction. So you don't require any other fraud or fraudulent intention, deceit, everything. Now go back to the first statement which I made. What Supreme Court said in case of fraudulent, there should be a deceit, intention to deceive, and an injury to the person who was deceived. Now here all those parameters are not there. Only parameter is that there is a creditor who has to recover. Now instead of satisfying the creditor, you try to deal with the property which defeats his right. He doesn't have a right to look back to the property. That is how TP Act dealt with. From there, I took you to the other things of Companies Act, how liabilities were fastened. So there is a vast difference which is happening in the context of the topic for today.
Thank you, sir. I just want the citation of that 1973-1 SEC. I was not fast enough to note down. Can you repeat it again?
That first definition which I gave you.
No, that is in AIR 1963 Supreme Court. I have noted and put it in the chat box. The second one, 1973-1 SEC. That part I missed to note.
1973-1 SEC.
Yes.
What are the judgment which I said?
No, I missed it. That's why I'm asking. Okay.
Name. Sorry, I'll get you. 1 minute.
Was it Dr. Vimala?
No. That Vimala is 1963 Supreme Court, sir.
Regarding directors, sir. Regarding directors.
Yes. I'll tell you.
Use the word which is so obvious to him.
1973-1 SEC 602. Official liquidator versus Supreme. I think official liquidator Supreme Bank Limited versus P. A. Tendulkar. 1973-1 SEC 602.
I think Ashok, unmute yourself.
I'm already unmuted. I just was waiting for the host to give me the permission. Okay, now please, sir.
Whether fraud is arbitrable?
No, fraud is not arbitrable. Yes, Ashok.
Okay, sir. My question is simple. With respect to the Transfer of Property Act, it deals with fraudulent transfer in such a manner that a person who is making the claim has to prove it.
Yes.
Whereas it is now completely changed to the effect, a simpliciter saying that the creditor's interest has been defeated is sufficient. Earlier in the Presidency Insolvency Act, that was a cause for a petition to be filed under Insolvency Act. Exactly. How do you see this paramount change of proof being made, and is the concept of entire thing burden shifting, and will this not have a incorrect balance of anyone trying to bring up?
Correct. That is where I said even under the Transfer of Property Act, the judge made law or the court made law, in fact, traveled far beyond what the provision made. Provision said voidable, therefore a requirement of filing suit. I will try to get the judgment today. I couldn't immediately lay.
Hello?
Supreme Court, in fact, has said that if the creditor files an execution petition and seeks to proceed against a particular property, and in the process, if it is found that property has been transferred, the court said you can just avoid. So, therefore, that burden of proof or burden which was there was diluted by subsequent judgments. So it only said if it is established that it was to defeat the right of the creditor, that is enough. So therefore, a decree holder who is there in an execution can just say that I am avoiding it. This is what is Supreme Court judgment. I will circulate the judgment also.
Okay.
So that travel had happened in TP Act itself.
TP Act itself.
Further to IBC, it has now come to the stage of entering different way.
Probably those judgments now justify the present law.
Yes.
Thank you.
I just want to share a small thought process.
Hmm.
This being an act which involves some element of criminality into the act of the directors or whoever involved in the transaction.
Yes.
Would it not proper that a criminal trial should gone into in these kind of matters to find out whether the transaction is undervalued or fraudulent or it's an avoidant transaction?
As far as IBC provisions are concerned, that is not required. But having said this, I have to put it this way. Other than the provisions which I had pointed out, there is also a provision for prosecution against these people. So that is entirely a different thing. Prosecution is there, it can go before special court. A prosecution under the IBC can also be on a point that you failed to avoid the corporate insolvency being triggered. So that is also a point of prosecution. So that is entirely different. As regarding these transactions, that is why I read the provision which said the tribunal is sufficient to ask for only an expert opinion, which effectively means today is an auditor's report. If an auditor gives a report, which is normally termed as a forensic report, saying that these transactions qualify, and if they are able to identify from the flow of funds or the value of the asset, see, in all companies you have got these valuations of the assets on record, you also get the valuations from other sources. If that is identified, that is sufficient. So beyond that, IBC doesn't look forward for any criminal prosecution, or your doubt that it may require a prosecution to be done is not supported by the provisions of the court.
That is exactly my thought process. Like in the Companies Act also, when somebody alleges that the particular transaction is an undervalued or voidable transaction, there it is a voidable transaction. There is no need for full trial. It's a summary proceedings. The High Court can decide based on the arguments and based on the documents. Likewise, in IBC also, based on the argument and document, it can be decided. So my thought process is, why can't these kind of aspects, because criminality being involved into these kind of transactions, yet a detailed trial should go into these kind of matters?
They are not even identifying it to a criminality. For setting aside this transaction or for terming a transaction as fraudulent, as I said, only criteria is if it is to defeat the rights of the creditors. Point one. So far as you have incurred a debt and there is a creditor, it is your prudence which is more important. They only say that you have to be diligent in doing a business. So they are not even looking at the criminality for that. If this is established, they want that the property has to come back or the transaction has to be set aside. And from the director's point of view, or from as against the director, they are only looking at disgorgement. You make good the money. That is the end of it. And the other area is the prosecution. So I don't think in the context in which it is made in the commercial sense, we cannot stretch it even for a thought process to say that it should be part of a criminal prosecution.
Yes, in fact, under the company's provisions, if OL wants to make a claim against a debtor to the company, the matter will go to the master court and a full trial will be conducted. And here, it is a reverse concept. Doesn't have any kind of trial or proving the point beyond the documentation and the argument.
Correct.
So it is only my thought process that it actually started from the Companies Act 1956 itself. And in fact, there are many contra judgments by Bombay High Court and Delhi High Court saying that these kind of matter has to go into a trial and need not go into a trial. It can be decided summary proceedings also. Okay. But under IBC, there is no contra judgments. There is no questioning of these kind of transactions should be put on trial. So it's only a thought process.
You have not evolved much law on that. It is likely to come. Yes. What happened is that the IBBI has now put up a document in its website based on various stakeholders' views, saying red flags on avoidance transactions. Now they are trying to educate you on the point as to how you have to find out avoidance transaction red flags. So this is one thing. Now when you said about this misfeasance and malfeasance application company code, I also said one thing. What is the success rate? You are going for trial, master's evidence, whatever we said, no? Even at that point of time, you have many people who are only let off. Success rate is hardly 5%. You did not have any directors accountable for whatever misfeasance actions you have done. Point number one. And point number two, if you had practiced on the company side, you will also appreciate the point. The liquidator will come with an evidence in these applications is nothing but the statement of affairs filed by the director and books of account. To my knowledge, I have not seen any other evidence which was even brought before. You will only say books of account, I am marking it. And books of account will say that on this date, the company had this asset. And a subsequent financial year, the company did not have an asset. Statement of affairs will be marked. This had been the only thing. So therefore, the lawmakers thought that was not giving much of a result. Make more stringent so that the director's responsibility and obligations will be more.
Exactly.
Thank you.
Okay, sir. With no questions forthcoming, I think. Yes, Satish can ask.
Sir, I have one doubt, sir. This is regarding the statement of affairs, filing of statement of affairs.
Yes.
See, regarding the old Act 1956, we are aware this filing of statement of affairs is mandatory once the winding up is ordered.
Yes.
But normally in practice, these directors, they take their sweet time. And they used to file a condone delay application. Our courts will be liberal in condoning that. And they will file a standard format of statement of affairs. Though there are more than one directors, identically they will be filing also. Now, how different this aspect has been made in 2013 Act? That is one aspect of the question. And the other aspect is, sir, in 2013 Act, is there any consequences for non-filing of statement of affairs?
Yes, 2013 Act also provided more stringent measures. It also provided for consequences. But ultimately what has happened is that today you don't have winding up.
Yes.
Goa Act spoke about it. By a subsequent amendment, they said all winding up proceedings in this particular chapter will be in terms of IBC code.
IBC, yes.
So no more point in just getting into that provision and trying to find what. If it comes to IBC, situation changes. In the earlier winding up proceedings, they were in possession, liquidator takes possession, liquidator gets into, you was depending on it. IBC, the resolution provision is put in possession. Resolution provision is given wider powers. He can examine everything. And for in the IBC, there is no question of statement of affairs. IBC, all records has to be given to the liquidator. He takes into it. Then he examines. Now he can call upon them to explain anything. Section 19.2 makes and provides for the resolution professional to file any number of applications before the NCLT calling for all details. And that is where I said the code even goes to the extent of saying that the resolution professional can take the assistance of experts. Experts ultimately, either company secretaries, chartered accountants or advocates. Now in IBC, you are getting so many matters where opinions are sought from advocates. Similarly, reports are sought from chartered accountants. This is one expanding area which is happening. So more we are educated on this, you may also get an opportunity to look into this. You may have to advise them. You may have to give an opinion. Many a cases of these fraudulent transactions or avoidance transactions applications which are coming before NCLT is that based on the auditor's report of forensic. I was happy to note at least in some application, there is also an opinion of a lawyer which is placed as a record. Saying that we have taken an opinion of a lawyer and this is what the lawyer has said. And that today, mostly the major firms are doing. Maybe once we are equipping ourselves and we are also coming into the fray, we also will have a say in those matters.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Satish.
Now I call upon Ashok to say a vote of thanks.
Thank you, Siva. This particular topic which has been addressed today, one would think that fraudulent transfers is a very age-old topic, even before the birth of any one of us here. It is such an old topic. But today, the speech has proven that it is not old enough to be redundant. It is so very live, and there are so much of space still to be occupied and still being progressive. Even the last question, what Satish had said, has been thought-provoking, and it shows that how much more is left. And as again, I take the reference of Arvind Ghosh, who said, it's a very large topic and very extensive topic. which the learned senior advocate had put it in a very concise manner and presented to us. And that was amazing. In fact, I use the word amazing. And we could get the inputs of it very easily. And the travel between the Transfer of Property Act to the Old Companies Act and the New Companies Act and the insolvency was a smooth rhythm which followed. And that was excellent. And that was absolutely his style of presenting it in a flow. And we really enjoyed it and learned a lot. Thank you so much, sir. And I also thank all the participants for actively participating. And thanks once again.
Thank you. Thank you all.
Thank you. And this marks the end of the session. Thank you.